So far we have been studying stochastic contextual bandits. We just observed that these stochastic contextual bandits can be considered as a special case of stochastic linear bandits when we assume the mean rewards are linear. Okay. In the last class, we discussed some algorithms and we just discussed the broad sketch of how the proof goes about under some assumptions, and then we said using some special techniques we should be able to relax those assumptions and prove the regret bounds whatever we claimed. So we'll just left it there. Now that was the part for the stochastic case, and in the assignment you are going to look into some problems on that, and also you are going to look into some algorithms for this stochastic bandit case. So now we are going to move to the case when my setup can be adversarial. So far my rewards were all stochastic, but I could as well consider the case when my rewards are adversarial, right? So how does my contextual bandits work for the adversarial case? So the setup is same as earlier, except that when you have a context, the reward associated with that context from an arm need not be coming drawn from a fixed distribution. It could be chosen in an arbitrary fashion, and in particular that could be selected by an adversary. So we will consider the following setup. I'm going to denote C to be the set of context. Okay. For t equals to 1, 2, following happens. So this C set of context is assumed to be fixed. It is some set from which the contexts are drawn in every round. Okay. So the learner observes context from that set, and the learner So let's say there are k arms. So the learner observing this CT context is going to select a distribution on this k arms, and let's say samples IT from PT. He is going to play an arm, and for that he correspondingly learner observes xt, which is nothing but xt it. Maybe what should I do is here I will insert another line. This is environment. Science. Okay, so let's go through this. We are saying that in every round T, learner observes the context and the environment assigns the reward vector in that round to each of my arms, and then learner select a distribution PT on these arms. So what does learner, how does he select PT? He observes the context in that round T, and based on that he is going to come up with a distribution, but he does not see the rewards assigned by the environment in that round. And then whatever, he is going to sample an arm according to the dash distribution, and he is going to get a reward that he actually played in that round. So XT IT is the reward that is assigned to arm IT in round T, and this is what his reward in that round T. Okay, now so this is how the interaction between the learner and the environment is happening here. Now our goal is, as usual, to compare the performance of a learner against the best reward I would have got if I knew all the reward assignments. Okay, so then we are going to define regret, or the expected regret, as of a policy, whatever policy pi we have. Expected value of, now notice that so okay, what we are doing here, what is this quantity here? This quantity says that suppose you fix a context, so for time being assume that this C is finite. Okay, now take a context and look which is the arm that gives the maximum reward for that context. Okay, and then sum it over all possible context, right? So notice that when I am saying this, I am only looking at all counting, adding the rewards for which the context in round T is C. So this is for a particular say, this is giving me the total reward accumulated when I saw particular context C, and now this is the total reward I would have accumulated over T periods. And now this I am comparing against the reward I would have collected by playing my policy pi. So how does this pi affect this XT? So according to that policy pi is going to tell how I am going to choose my distribution in every round, and accordingly I would have drawn some arm. I play that arm, and for that particular arm I am going to receive the corresponding reward. So all these XTs are governed by my policy pi, and that is why this is the total reward I would have accumulated over a time period T, and this is what I would have gotten. So here we are looking, so this is what we would have got. Now what we are comparing this against is a benchmark. This is my benchmark. In this I am saying I am looking for the best reward I would have got for each possible context, right? So I am going to take a context and I am going to see what is the best reward I would have got here. Yeah, No, I don't care it. Why should I write it about like you, whatever you do, you are seeing it CT, it may be up to you, you want to use it or ignore it. Let it be in whatever way it is. I just want to, this is my total reward I would have got. And this is what my cumulative reward is. Where I am saying it is for single context, it is you take a C, but you only look those rewards in which the context is C. Out of like this 100, that particular C may have occurred only 10 times. Only for those 10 times you would are now looking for which is the best term you would have like to pick. Yeah, but why we have to write specifically CT equals to exactly doing that job. We are only restricting this sum to only those points in which in the teeth round the context is C. Right, but you are not summing it.
No, but if there was a different XPI for each context, then this would not
happen. Different XTI for, see in round T you have a context CT,
yes.
Right?
And we have a vector.
We have a vector assigned for each arm.
So that vector of rewards, is there a vector of rewards for each context or there is just a single?
There is a vector of reward here for whatever the context that has been observed in that round, right? Yeah, it is not defined at that time. Whatever the context happens that time, for that you have this reward. And if that in that context, if it happens to be C, then you are going to do this. Otherwise, this sum is zero. Now, rewriting we can do it in different ways. Is this fine? If this is the total reward I am going to get over time period T, and here I am looking at for every possible context what is the best reward I would have gotten. Is this fine? Or if this, okay, fine. Now suppose there is only one context, okay. So there is only one context means this summation, there is no, this summation I do not need to worry about, right? In every time CT equals to C. Is this the standard adversarial setup I have? So there I am looking at that the best single best arm against what I would have got. But now that I have different possible context, now I am looking at for every context what is the best I would have obtained. So now, so what it is saying is basically see like I as of now I know that like my optimal arm could depend on my context. Whenever that context I appear observe, I want to see over the duration wherever I have observed this context what is the best action I would have taken in hindsight. So what is this part doing? Wherever I saw context C, it is giving me the total reward you accumulated whenever you saw that C. Now max over IK is telling that in hindsight if you know all those XTIs for that corresponding C, what is the best action you should have played and what is the best corresponding reward you have gotten. And now this is for all possible context and now you are trying to compare it with what is that cumulative reward you would have got. Okay, fine. So now obviously you want to minimize this. Okay, now let us start thinking about, suppose for a particular contest, what is my regret? This is over all possible contexts, right? For a particular context, I am going to write it as and then CT equals to this particular context and then I am going to write XTI. Now I am going to write it inside this. So now I am only focusing on those instances where I have observed my context C. I have fixed my context C now. Now I am seeing what is the regret I am going to incur for that particular context. The best I could have got for that context is this sum, and minus this, this is the reward I would have accumulated whenever I saw that particular context. Okay. Yes. So in that case, what is RT pi is going to be? Simply going to be the sum of all these terms, as long as I assume that my contexts are finite. Okay. Okay. Now let's focus on this. How you are going to deal with each context? Yes, there are multiple contexts, but if you focus only on particular context, you are already in a known territory, right? You are, what is that? That is the standard adversarial bandit setting, you already know. Okay. So do you like whenever, now you can, what you can do for each particular context, you can run an exp3 algorithm. Yes. Like exp3 algorithm was maybe like the standard adversarial setting was a special case of this, where it is assumed there is only one context. Now that we have multiple contexts, so I could run different exp algorithms for each of these contexts. Anyway, I know this context, I know how many contexts are there. For each context, I would like to run a different exp algorithm. Now if I do that, what is the regret I am going to get for this particular context C? Can I write a bound on this? So let us say this, I am now on to write RTC, where I am going to use my policies exp3. What could be the bound I am going to get? So my context particular C is appearing only at some points. It is not like it is appearing in every round. At some point it is appearing. Let us say out of 100 rounds I ran, only 10 times this particular context C appeared. Now if I have that information, can I write what is the regret bound I could get on this if I apply exp3 algorithm? What is that? So what is the general, so what is the, for the standard setup, what is the regret bound we get by applying exp3? So we get something like a 2 times square root kt log k, right? What was t there? Number of times you have played. But that t is the same t you are going to get here? No, right? What is that t is going to be? Number of times you have observed the context, right? So in that case, can I write it as So what is this? This is basically telling you the number of times my context C has been observed, right? Under which this is the bound. But notice that we got this bound in exp3 by assuming that we knew the time horizon, right? So in exp3 we needed to tune a parameter eta, right? That parameter eta dependent on what? The time horizon. But when I am going to apply exp3 on this setup, I a priori do not know how many times I am going to see this particular context C, right? It may appear on all the rounds, or it may never appear, or it may appear only on few of the instances. Now how you are going to apply exp3? Yeah, so we could use the case where we do not know the time horizon, then what we do, we usually do the doubling trick. But with the doubling trick, we know that we almost get the same regret bound with some constant factor loss in the regret bound, right? So fine, we can still do this then. I just keep doing the doubling trick And with that, I'm going to get this as my regret bound. So then my RT phi is nothing but summation C belongs to C RT C phi. And if I'm going to use my exp3 kind of algorithm, let's say I'm going to get is okay, so we have this regret bound if I get it. So now, but somehow this upper bound here appears like it depends on what is the sequence of context I observed, right? So let's try to get rid of that. What is the sequence of context I observed? Let's try to get a bound here which is independent of the sequence of context observed. So can you apply a Cauchy-Schwarz inequality on this and see what is the bound you are going to get? We have been doing this trick many times, right? So treat this as, so let's say there is a 1 here. This is 1 into some quantity. Treat it as a product of AI into BI, where AI are all 1, BI are all changing for each context. So now if you apply on this Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, what is the bound you are going to get? So keep the constant outside. If I do that, so I am going to get summation A equals to summation C belongs to C 1 square. Then summation C belongs to C, the square of this term, which is k log k times t equals to 1 to capital T indicator C t equals to C. So what I will do now is, so this is cardinality of C. The first term is simply cardinality of C. Okay, so is this correct if I just apply Cauchy-Schwarz inequality on this? So now just what is this term is going to be? This term is going to be simply capital T, right? So this is so what has just happened is if you are going to simply apply each context as a separate, for each context you are going to think it as a separate adversarial bandit problem and apply, maintain an exp algorithm for each context, then this is the regret you are going to get. And how this regret has scaled compared to the single contextual bandit? By square root of cardinality of C, this much of. So as long as you are context size is finite, that is cardinality is finite for C, you could apply CXP3 for maintaining it separately for each context, and you are going to still get a sublinear regret like this. It is, this regret is still sublinear, right? But as long as fix it, I mean this is about fix, you are not going to vary, your variables here are t, other quantities you have to fix, whatever C you are going to choose, then that is fixed for cardinality C, then it is sublinear in T. Okay. Okay, fine. Then the question is, what if this cardinality of C is large, then this regret bounds can be very bad, right?